so far. That sounds a lot better. Let me tell you how this works. This is the last night scheduled for our revival. But the thing has been wonderful. Our pastor is back with us tonight. So we have a lot to look forward to. God can do anything. He can touch anyone. In fact, He can touch everybody at the same time. If you will sit back and enjoy what He has in store for you, He'll receive God's word. He can move so wonderfully, so amazing. We can't even imagine. But you know what? We have to be ready and willing to receive what He has in store for us. Are you ready for that? We don't seem too excited about that. He is. Well, that was probably deserved. Are y'all excited about that? Are y'all excited to be here tonight? Are you ready for one more night of revival? We can do it. Okay? Be ready for what God has in store for us. Let's all turn our handles to hymn number 469. Hymn number 469. We're going to sing the first, second, and last verse. And let's all stand while we sing.
Right. doesn't have a relationship with you. Lord, I pray today would be the day of salvation for them. Lord, stir us. Lord, encourage us. Challenge us that we would not leave here the same people we were when we walked in. And Father, we praise you. We worship you. And we honor you. We just ask all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. And my family said with me.
to the church tonight. Amen. I've been in over 800 and some of revivals, and I've never had a preacher backslid so bad that he wouldn't come to church. Amen. And so I'm just glad he's here. I want you to know I love your beloved pastor. He's a great, great man of God, and I appreciate his love for God's people and how he loves lost people. I was sharing last night how everybody loves lost people, and your beloved pastor does. And what a blessing that is. And we're good friends, too. And I like him for a lot of reasons. I know he has hair, and I know that. But I like him because when he preaches, he sweats, amen. And I sweat when I preach. Matter of fact, I would trust a preacher that doesn't sweat just a little bit, amen. And I would never trust a music company that sweat, amen. And I tell you, I go to these churches, and they've got these little skinny singers. You know what I'm talking about, skinny singers? I don't like them. I'll just be honest with you. I want to sing it. It sweats a little bit, amen. And though I'm just joking, I'm being silly and silly with you. Let's go forward together in prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we love you. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come. And Lord, open up the Word of God and share the good news of Christ. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the 12 men, women, and young people that this week have been birthed into the family of God. God, we give you the glory, the honor, the praise. Lord, they did the asking, and you did the saving. You did the changing of the heart, the drawing, Lord, of their soul to you. And Lord, we give you glory and honor and praise. And God, we ask you to bless again tonight. Lord, that we be encouraged, that we be challenged, and Lord, that we live for you and serve you in a much greater way. It is our hope that there's someone here that has never been saved, never been born again. Lord, they'll not leave you lost, but rather they'll be able to say, for as long as I am saved, and I know that I am, I'm ready for heaven, as if I was already there. But then, Lord, may God's people tonight be encouraged, challenged to live for you and serve you in a great way. Lord, we love you, pray that you'll bless as we share. And Lord, let there be a freedom in our invitation for people to respond. We pray these things in your name, the name above all names, the greatest name that I know, the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's people say, amen. Well, tonight, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to open them and turn with me to the book of Romans, a very familiar passage, Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. We're going to look at verse 1 and verse 2. Now, I'm just going to be honest with you. I've got a few good sermons. I've got a lot of sorry sermons, but I've got a little few good sermons. And I'm just going to be upfront with you tonight. This is probably not a good sermon. I've had the opportunity already to preach about being a true friend, about being a witness, and serving the Lord and reaching others with the gospel of Christ. I've had the opportunity to talk about other gods. Remember, the God of pleasure, the God of prosperity, the God of people. Also, we talked about one of the rich and one of the famous found in the Word of God. And you remember her name. Her name was Lydia. And then also, last night, we had the opportunity to preach about the family and how the family matters, how the family matters to God, and things we must do if we're going to have a successful family in this culture, in this day and time. But tonight, I want to really share just a very simplistic message that I hope will take heed to your heart. And we read about this, Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 2. Paul is coming to us not as a great preacher, not as a missionary, not as a church planter, but rather, I believe Paul is coming to us really as an exhorter, or maybe he's coming as someone that would give us guidance or wisdom, maybe a counselor. That's what he says. He says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren. Now, by the way, this is talking to believers. This is not talking to lost friends. We love them. We want them to come to know the Lord. And if you're here tonight, if you have never been born again or born from above, I hope before you leave here tonight, you'll be able to settle that in your heart that you know Jesus as Lord and as Savior. But Paul is saying, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be what transformed or changed by the renewing of your mind, that he might prove what is a good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now let's really look at this again. Again, he says, I beseech you, I urge you, I challenge you, therefore, brethren. I challenge you, therefore, Christian mother, Christian father, teenager, that have been born again by the mercies of God. Now, I'll be honest with you, we did right. Right over here, we can start with Miss Carrie Gibbs. I'm not going to do that tonight, but we can do us all stand up and just take a moment, and we could all just share all the mercies that God has blessed us with. And I believe you would agree with me that we would be here long after our normal revival service time, because we would be able to stand and give God the glory and the honor and the praise for all the blessings and all the mercies that God has bestowed upon us. I believe I shared with you earlier this week, I encourage you, and maybe in your quiet time, to take a piece of paper and a pen and just begin to write down all the blessings and all the mercies that God has given you. And I believe you'll be surprised. I believe you'll be shocked as you go back in your mind and in your memory how God has been with you, how He's never left you, He's never forsaken you. He's always been there as a child of God, right there by your side. And see, He says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Now, He's not asking us to die for Him, but rather He is asking us to live for Him. You say, Brother Tim, I love Jesus. Well, I really do. But Brother Tim, if the communists were to come into our land, or the Taliban were to come into America, and they were to capture America, and they were on the coming before a firing squad and say, you renounce the name of Jesus, or you burn your Bible, or we're going to kill you, I would be bold. I would stand there and say, never, I'll never renounce the name of Jesus Christ. He is my Lord. He is my Savior. He is my Master. Oh, but dear friend, the Bible here is not asking us to die for Christ, but rather Paul is challenging us to what? To live for Christ. And many times in our life it might be a little easier to die for Christ than even to live for Christ. But oh dear friend, what a joy it is to live for Christ. But what a wonderful thing it is to let the light of Christ shine in and through you, and that it might bring glory and honor to our blessed Lord, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So many of you, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. By the way, is for the reason. I mean, really and truly, I'll never say, Lord God, here's my life, here's my body. Very reasonable, God, that I would give my life, my all back to thee. And then he says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye changed or be transformed. He's believing, Brother Tim. I don't know if you know this, but you live over there, Darien, and we live over here between Harlem and Augusta. And you know, Augusta is a part of Georgia, and Georgia is a part of America, and America is a part of the world. And so, what do you mean, do not be a part of this world? Well, though we live in the world, we're not going to be a part of the world. In other words, God gets changed in your life. Ladies and gentlemen, when you came to faith and you asked Christ to come into your life, to be the Lord and to be your Savior, a change should have taken place. By the way you respond, by the way you walk, by the way you talk, by the way you live, by the way you act, by the way you serve, things that you do and things you do not do, not suitable to heaven, but because you're going to heaven, you ought to wait, make our Jesus glad, and you should never want to make our Savior sad. So what's the Bible say? Be not conformed to this world, but be ye changed or transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So, let me ask you a question. What is God's perfect will? God's perfect will. What does that mean when we say live a life that is pleasing to God? Really, all that is meaning is this. All it's saying is this. Live holy. In other words, have a life full of holy living. And by the way, the only way you can live a life that is a victorious life, the only way you can live a life that is a glorious life, is to live a life that is full of Jesus. Amen? A life that is surrendered and committed to Him. I know some of you are saying, wait a minute, Brother Tim. I understand what Paul's saying. Paul's saying, as a child of God, that I should be willing to give my life or give my body a living sacrifice to Him. But you know, he's really asking a lot. Because you understand, Brother Tim, everything I do it with my body. For instance, I talk with my body. I think with my body. I eat with my body. Some of us see with our body. I smell with my body. I eat with my body. I make my living with my body. I take my children through my body. Everything I do it with my body. What does God have asked me, a child of God, to give myself or yield myself to him a holy living dedicated 16 or might be a teenager here tonight and say, hey, you know, I'm just 13 years old. Hey, man, I'm just, you know, barely 17 years old. What right would God ever have to ask me, just a kid, to give my life to Him, my body, a holy living, dedicated, surrendered sacrifice? I'll be honest with you, I can give you a whole lot of reasons. And then I can go over to your pastor and you give you a whole lot of other reasons. But tonight, I just want to mention three very simple reasons. Three very simplistic reasons why we should be willing to say, Lord God, here is my life. Here is my all. Here is my life. God, I give it all to you. You think about it. Here's my mind, Lord, anything, things that are pleasing, honoring to thee. Lord, here are my eyes, let them see things that are a blessing to you. Lord, here are my ears, let them hear things that promote the gospel, that are pleasing and honoring to you. Lord, here's my tongue. The Lord, guard my tongue that I'll not hurt someone, I'll not gossip, I'll say pleasing things, honoring things, blessed things. Lord, here's my heart, let it be to the heartbeat of Christ. Lord, here are my hands. Lord, here are my fingers. Let them serve you. Here are my feet. Lord, let them go places that are a blessing to you. Lord, here is my heart. And let it be to the heartbeat of Christ. Lord, here is my life. I yield myself to thee. Number one, first reason. Because God made us and allowed us to be born alive. But you say, buddy, is that all you got? Well, it gets a little bit better, but that's pretty good. If you think about God made us, God made this mind, He made these ears, He made this tongue, He made these hands and these feet and legs, God made this heart, God breathed into our nostrils the breath of life. Well, listen to me, He gave us this computer we call a brain or a mind. Oh, dear friend, He gave us life. Since He gave us life, we should be willing to say, Lord God, I give my life back to you. Have you ever done that? Have you ever said, Lord God, here's my life. I yield myself to you. I give my all to you. You say, oh, Brother Tim, listen, I'm a Sunday school teacher, Brother Tim. Listen, I'm a deacon, brother. Hey, Brother Tim, I'm sitting in the choir. Hey, listen, I'm there Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Hey, man, I was like born in church. I've been on drugs all my life. Glad to Sunday school. Glad to Sunday morning. Glad to Sunday night. Hey, man, I've always been in church. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. And you might even be born again, but have you ever given your all to the Lord Jesus Christ? Friend, number one, because it made us, but number two, there's a simple reason. Not only did it make us, but God keeps us. Now, I know some of you are saying, wait a minute, Brother Tim, the reason I'm alive is because I ain't chicken, I ain't fish. I've never walked out in front of big trucks, and I've never fly on Delta Airlines. The reason I'm alive is because I take care of my. Now, let's be honest with you, right? See, you're the only reason you're alive as a child of God is because the Holy God has said no to Satan. You're not going to hurt my child. I want you to know that Satan is real. It's no joke. And I know folks laugh about Satan. They joke about Satan. They joke about hell. And they say, man, if I go to hell, I'm going to have all my buddies. And we're going to party in hell. Just be reminded that there's no party in hell. There's no joy in hell. There's no peace in hell. There's no love in hell. By the way, there's no Jesus in hell. And Satan would love to destroy you. This is as a mere teenager to destroy your life. You think about your schoolmates. How Satan has destroyed many of their lives already. And their family's lives are ripped apart and destroyed. Oh, they said, no, the reason you're alive is the Holy God has said, no, you're going to hurt my child. I think about these choir members that sang a moment ago. The only reason that they're able to sing, have the mental aptitude to stand and sing songs a moment ago, is because God has said, no, you're not going to hurt my child. I think about these guys that play these instruments. And by the way, you got a little bit of amen and amen. I want to hear you, man. But by all the same, Satan wants you to play those fiddles. He doesn't want you to play those guitars. He doesn't want you to play instruments that bring glory and honor to the Lord. But listen, that is the only reason you're alive, because the Holy God has said, no, Satan, you will not hurt my child. Hands off my child. I think about our Sunday school teachers. May I enjoy this honor. Let me have Sunday, not Sunday, but let me. By afternoon. And those who teach teach our senior adults, man, what a blessing that is. And those that teach our middle-aged adults and our young adults, man, how to hang in there and say no to divorce and yes to giving surrender to the Lord. And thank God for men and women that will teach our teenagers and even those that work on a regular basis with little boys and little girls. Isn't that wonderful? What a great ministry that is to be a blessing to see little boys and girls come to faith in Christ. But all dear friends, Sunday school teacher tonight, the reason that you're still with us is because the Holy God has said, no, you will not hurt that child. Oh, dear friend, what are we about? God, you made me. God, you keep me. At least I should be willing to say, Lord God, here's my wife. Lord, here's my husband. Lord, here's my wife. Lord, here's my children. Lord, here's my grandchildren. Here's my mom, my dad. Here's my little brother. Take my little brother. Keep my little brother down. You have a little brother. Lord, here's my big sister. But God, here's my abilities. Here's my giftedness. Here's my faults. Here are my difficulties. Here are my shortcomings. Here is my intelligence. Lord, here's my money. Here are my resources. Here's my truck. Here's my car. Here's my golf cart. Lord, here's my preparation. God, here is my church. Here is my preacher. Here is my family. I give you my all. He made us. He keeps us. And there's a third reason that we'll wrap it up. The third reason is this: that God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, Jesus, that lived no sin, could die on the cross for you and for me. Not only die, but be risen from the grave after being buried and then ascended into the glories of heaven. The Bible says He's at the right hand of the Father. And He's looking at any of you tonight, and some of you say, I know you. But I know you, and I know you, and I know you. And I met you the other night, and hey, buddy, I met you last night. And somebody, you say, I love you, but I don't know you, but I want to get to know you. By the way, you get to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior this very day, this very evening. Without being able to say, Lord, God, since you gave me life, since you gave me, since you gave yourself for me, since God, you gave yourself for me to die and be risen, that has the power to cleanse me and forgive me of my sin and to save my soul from hell to heaven. Lord God, here is my all, here is my life. I give it all to thee. You know, I realize that most Baptist churches, we hear about the cross. Praise God for preachers that still preach on the cross. But you know that not all preachers preach on the cross. And we've got preachers that are pretty famous today. They'll not preach about sin, and they'll not even talk about the blood. I remember hearing a famous singer by the name of Cynthia Fawcett, and she had the opportunity one time to sing at the Crystal Cathedral. Y'all used to watch maybe that on television, that beautiful, television, beautiful scenery, and a beautiful church building. She was told, do not sing about the blood. And she said, why not? Because that might be offensive. Oh, dear friend, I want you to know that's offensive to me, amen. That's but if it wasn't for the blood of Jesus cleansing us of all of our sin, if it wasn't for Christ and His willingness to die and shed His blood, and spill it, He didn't spill it like an accident, He didn't spill it like coffee or coke. He shed His blood for you and for me. Oh, dear friend, if it hadn't been for Jesus, man, I'd be lost in this whole world. I would die in my sins. I would spend an eternity in a place called hell. If you think about the cross, you think about Calvary. And then when they took Jesus before that Roman governor by the name of Pilate, Pilate examined him and he said, I find no fault in this man named Jesus. Once you know, friends, that statement was true that day, and that statement is still true today. Because Jesus never lied, he never cheated, never hated, never lusted, never coveted. Jesus Christ knew no sin. Jesus Christ had never sinned. But he would do the right thing, and what the people wanted him to do. And they were yelling that Jesus Christ be crucified, or that Jesus Christ be murdered or killed. Can you imagine the Roman governor saying, I find no fault in this man named Jesus, but I want you to take him down into the lower room of this building. I want you to take him out in the courtyard, and I want you soldiers to scourge him or to whip him. Can you imagine if they would take him outside, maybe in time, or maybe to a post, and they would lay his body maybe over a rack, a made of stone, a made of wood, and they would take his clothing with their hands, and they would wrap his body. Can you imagine if they were going to laugh at Jesus and mock Jesus? Can you imagine teenagers, they would take the swallow or the spit in their mouth and begin to spit in the face and spit on the body of our Savior, Jesus Christ? And the Bible says they would take their fish and they would smoke him. Now, I want you to know these were not a bunch of feminine sissies. Living on the streets of Atlanta, Georgia, with purple hair and earrings in her eyelids. These guys were mighty warriors. These guys were soldiers. These guys were like professional athletes in our day and time. Can you imagine if Jesus Christ, they laughed at him and mocked him, they would take their fists and they would beat him in the belly and they would beat him in the face because they hated him. Well, they took things about the size of a little league baseball bat called reeds. They would use reeds in times of riots where they would pull out a sword and hurt themselves and they would hurt an innocent bystander. Can you imagine if they mocked Jesus and cussed Jesus and spat upon Jesus? As they would beat Jesus, they would take those knives and they would hit him in the back and they would hit him in the legs and they would hit him in the belly because they hated him. Jesus Christ would be there. They took a whip on the catabolic hills. What it is, not a there is a handle about this long and maybe so ever so long. On this main piece of leather were eight other pieces of leather. They're making nine pieces of leather. And on the ends of those tips of those pieces of leather were pieces of gold, or pellets of iron shaped looks like a claw, that when that Roman soldier would come down on his back and then pull the whip back and come down on his back and then pull the whip back, at least nine pieces of flesh would be ripped from the back of Jesus Christ. 49 times. They came down on the back of Jesus Christ. Scholars say you could have put your fingers on his back without them slipping into deep gashes of blood. By the way, he did that for me. Ladies and gentlemen, he did that for you. Can I just make a simple statement? I'm going to say this tonight. I hope you'll agree with me. What a freedom. What a freedom. We have a Savior. What right do I have to say? No, God, this is my life. No, God, I want to do what I want to do. I'm going where I want to go. I want to drink what I want to drink. I'm going to smoke what I want to smoke. I'm going to run around and do what I want to do. I don't care what God says. I don't care that He loves me. I don't care that He died. I don't care that He's suffering. I don't care. I want to live my life the way I want to live it when He gave me life, when He keeps me alive, and when He gave Himself for you and for me. Oh, dear friend, you never want to have another chicken. Pilate again, and what did Pilate say? He looked at Jesus. And he said, "Behold the man." You know why he said that, "Behold the man"? Because most men at this point would probably be faint or at least die because of the pain, because of the agony, because of the loss of blood. Jesus did not faint, and at this point he had not died. Well, as he said, "Look at this man, boy! This man, I believe what Billy Graham said, the greatest evangelist of our era. He said, if there ever was a man that walked on the face of this earth, he would have to spell his name J-E-S-U-S, and that spells Jesus." I'll just be honest with you today, what we need in our nation today, we need men to be men for God. But could you imagine what God would do if men would just stand up on the promises of God? Be bold, Christian man for the Lord. Could you imagine what God would do if you guys have got small groups and again and I have prayer meetings and Bible time together and they can keep you together accountable? Could you imagine what would happen again in this world and men in our nation would stand up and be counted as men of God and take a stand for the things of God and a stand against sin? Can you imagine what God could do? Well, right here in our world, right here in our community, you know what else could be lost if he went? We need some teenagers to live for the Lord. By the way, teenagers, mom and dad, anybody can party. And anybody can drink. And anybody can snort drugs. Anybody can smoke reefer. And anybody can get pregnant this way. Anybody can have sex. And any teenager can do that stuff. I want you to know what we need is some young ladies and some men that take a stand for the Lord. Say no to sin, and yes to living a life committed for Christ. I tell you what, I always get some young men that really take a stand. Stand reaching their friends, reaching their neighbors, reaching their buddies for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The day will come and they'll move off, and you'll not have that opportunity to reach them anymore. That's why the Bible says, what today
is the day for salvation. He said, behold the man. Look at the, you know, the story. They took him in Hill called Calvary, and Hill called Bob, another place on the skull. And, you know, brother, we sing a lot of songs that are pretty about Calvary. And it's here, yeah, I bet you probably heard a lot of songs about Calvary and how beautiful Calvary is. But I want you to know there's only one thing beautiful about Calvary, and that is this. That's where Jesus Christ shed his blood on Calvary's cross for my sin and for your sin. By the way, Calvary was not a happy place. Calvary was not a beautiful place. Calvary was a place of death and pain and torment. Can you imagine Jesus as he would lay his body upon that cross and take nails on so long and place him right in between his hand and wrist, and they would draw that nail through his flesh. The blood of Jesus would get, or the blood of that man, the blood of Christ would get all over the hands of the man that would make it through the cross. They take another nail and put it right here and drive it through his wrist. And without breaking a single bone, the Roman way, they'd cross his feet and they'd drive the third nail through his feet. They put that cross into the earth. That cross would lean forwards. You know the story, they put a crown of thorns upon his brow. They mocked him, they laughed at him, they made fun of him. They put a spear into his side. And I imagine being there that day, and probably some women, maybe some older young people were there that day. And I can imagine them looking up there at the cross, looking at Jesus, and he had a thief on the right side and a thief on the left side. And I can imagine them laughing at him, saying, hey, Jesus, and yeah, you, the King of the Jews, if you're really the Son of God, why don't you deliver yourself? By the way, tonight we're not talking about some peasant boy from Galilee. We're talking about Jesus. We're talking about the Son of God. We're talking about the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the way I am, the Lord, our Shepherd, our Savior, our Master. By the way, you can call 10,000 angels. He could have said, 10,000 angels come and deliver me. He could have said, fire from heaven, come down and quench these men that are touched by fire with anger, and the fire from heaven will obey. He could have said, earth will have swallowed these men that have hurt me, and the earth will obey. But the Son of God, Jesus Christ, said, what? No man takes my life. No man takes my life. I freely give. He gave his life for me. He gave his life for me. He was standing again, one of three. Yeah. Jesus. Folks, what I'm going to say, Lord God, here's my mind. Guard my mind from trash. Guard my mind from pornography. Guard my mind. God, keep my mind pure and clean for your glory. Lord, hear my eyes. Let it listen to your eyes. Let them see things that bring glory to me. Lord, hear my ears. Hear my tongue. Lord, help me to be a witness. Help me to be a friend of encouragement. Help me to love friends. Lord, hear my hands. Let them serve you. Lord, hear my feet, my legs. Lord, let them go places that bring glory. Lord, here's my home. Here's my family. Here's my career. Here's my money. Here's my ability. Here's my retirement. Here's my motorcycle, my Indian motorcycle. Should be saved. I'm going to give you an opportunity in a moment to be saved. But to the child of God, I'm going to talk about simply have you ever yielded your life all to Him. You know what? Sometimes Christians do. They kind of give to the Lord, but then they take it back. Now, I think you've never done that, but I know this preacher has. I really need about a shout out to him, but I really don't need God. without that eternal joy that we have that fellowship and that relationship with the Lord. What a blessing that is. Sometimes we get to come back to the Father and say, Lord, you remember when I was 17 years old, I gave you my life. And I never knew I'd get a pretty girl like that in there. And then I never dreamed I'd have your little buddies, all kids. You know, what I came from, I didn't have much. But God, you blessed me financially. You blessed me with a good family and a good job. God, you've been so good to me. Lord, all this next time, I want to give it to you as well. Some of you need to get the new stuff to the Lord. And then let me share one more thing, and we'll kind of wrap it up tonight. What's the Bible say? I have used one scripture tonight, just mainly this one scripture. But the Bible says that be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is acceptable and perfect will of God. Go back to number 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. But sometimes we need to renew our mind. But all the old ones say it. But all the new ones say it. And sometimes we just need to come to the Father and say, Lord, I gave this to you. I don't know if I really yielded it, really surrendered it. Apparently not. And God, I've taken it back. Lord, you can handle my business better than I can. You can handle my family better than I can. You can handle my marriage better than I can. God, you can handle my kids better than I can. I want to encourage you. If you've never given your children the Lord, you'll do that. You say, I'm not afraid to help. We call it a mission field. I got one that's called a mission field. She's serving the Lord right now in Nicaragua with her husband and my little grandson. Full time on the mission field in Nicaragua. I'm so proud of them. But they're busy doing God's business. I would rather them be in Nicaragua than in America watching TV out of God's will. I'd rather them be serving the Lord in God's will. Have you ever done that? Have you ever given your marriage to the Lord? Have you ever given that old hubby to the Lord? You've tried all these years straightening it out. Let God straighten it out. I mean, really, give him to God. God, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to give to you. God, you got to do something this morning. Have you ever given your parents to the Lord? Lord, we struggle. We have issues. We have difficulties. God, let us die to self. I talked about that yesterday. Lord, let us just commit to you. God, here's our marriage. Lord, you bless it. You touch it. You give it direction. You give it guidance. Bless our marriage. Have you ever given your grandkids? I want you to know to get better. Amen. I got one that's 2 years old. Buddy, I want you to know I told you something. We went on vacation, and when I got home, I needed the vacation. Amen. I was telling you. That little buddy, this crazy little man, but you know what? I've already given it to you. It belongs to Christ. Have you ever given your reparation to the Lord? Have you ever given it? SUV, RV, whatever other kind of BBB, to the Lord. Have you given your time to the Lord? Have you given your money or things to the Lord? I want for this. I know God's given you the ability to get out of bed, go to work, and make money. Yeah. Have you yielded it to Him? Have you given it to Him? Have you given it? Here's my life. Here's my family. Here's my home. By the way, have you given your church to the Lord? You know, when it's God's church, God does mighty things in the church, but it's the people's church. They struggle. It needs to be not my way or his way or shit her way, but it needs to be God's way. I'm like, here's. I'm going to be honest with you. I love you. He's leading this fellowship to follow Jesus. That's a belief I will follow. I mean, really, if he's doing something immoral, that's a different story. And if he's teaching heresy, that's a whole different thing. If he's loving the Lord and serving the Lord and leading us biblically to walk with Jesus, man, I tell you, as a leader, I need to follow him. I've got to give you a picture of him. So y'all say, well, that's what we need to do. Amen. Amen. I preach it. Amen. Buddy, I was straight out of the board. Amen. That's right. It's not enough for me to do that. Give these studies to the class. And give these teenagers to them. Give these little boys and girls. Oh, they're so precious. Give that ministry to them. Talk about music. Give your music ministry. You know, really, as long as we're praising the Lord. And I'll be honest with you, I've got types of music. I'll just be honest with you, I don't really like. For instance, I like Southern Gospel. I really do. I like contemporary. I really do. I like hymns. I love hymns. I really do. I like praise courses. I really do. I love the McKinney's, but I don't really love their music. I'll just be honest with you. I love them. I want to have them in your church. I love them, but a little bit too twangy for me. And I'll be honest with you. I've been a serious Christian post-rock concert. It's just not my thing. Amen. I don't drive over there here. I want you to know, as long as my church is singing about Jesus and praising Jesus and giving honor to Jesus, I don't care if you use a fiddle or a guitar or a piano or even a drum or maybe even something else, man. Trumpet would be good too. By the way, it wouldn't hurt nothing. I want you to know, as long as we're singing and praising the Lord, we need to be happy about it. We need to give that to the Lord. Give it to the Lord. We're praying for your minister of music. Pray God will give him wisdom and direction and guidance. You think about it, he's got a minister of people 7 all the way up to 97. That's pretty tough. And then some of you do say, well, I don't like that. Have you ever heard that? No, I don't know. I know I've heard it much. I like that. I mean, there's just no way you'll make your money happy. But maybe what we need to make you happy, that's good. The Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but if I'm praying for my music team and I'm praying for my ministry of music and I'm praying that God will impress them on what to sing and what to lead us in, I'm going pretty happy for them. Because I know that they're singing about Jesus, they're praising Jesus, and I'm worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you ever done it? If you have, praise the Lord. If you haven't, tonight I want to give you an opportunity. Just in a moment to leave your seat, come down here to the old timey altar and kneel and begin to pray, Lord God, here I am. The good, the bad, the pretty, the ugly, the warts. Everything. God, here's my life. I give it to you. Here's my family. Here's my children. Here's my income, my retirement. Here's my life. I yield myself to you. And then do this for me. Say, Lord, is there anything else that I've missed? And if you're like me, he'll give you about 4 or 5 more things that you haven't even thought of. How he's blessed you with those things. And giving you those things. And say, Lord, I'm going to do my mind. Those belong to you as well. Somebody who never dreamed you'd ever be able to retire. You never dreamed you'd have a brand new truck. You thought I'm going to ride my dad's truck that's already, 25 years old. I mean, really. You can thank God. Thank you for providing. I give you that old truck out there. I've given it to you, Jesus. Here's my life. I yield myself to you. You made me. You keep me. And you gave yourself. Would you pray with me? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Heads about and eyes are closed. I told you we're going to be real simple tonight. I'm just going to be honest with you. It's going to be much simpler than that tonight. And sometimes, folks, you just got to get it down to where it looks like me can grab hold of it. I wonder how many here would say, well, it's the light of Jesus. I know him as my Savior. I remember the day that Jesus saved me. That's your testimony. Would you just simply lift your hand? I know Jesus as my Savior. And as you put your hand up, let's praise him. As you put your hand down, would you just thank you? Thank you.
thank you, Lord, for loving me, forgiving me, and saving me. Just thank you. As I look through now, I want some of you to raise your hand and show me you're able to, and thank you for your honesty. I mean, really, you could have lied about it, but you didn't. You could have lied to me, you could have lied to the Lord. You could lie to yourself, but I'll just be honest with you. You didn't lie to the Lord, but God knows your heart. And God knows if you belong to Him or not. I wonder how many others would say, but Sam, I'm not sure that I've ever really did say. But I know this, I want to die without Jesus. And Sam, I really don't want to die without sin. And Sam, I don't want to die without Jesus and go to hell. I need God's love. I need His forgiveness. Sam, I would like to be saved. And I'd like to be saved before soon. And I want to pray for you. They stand here, you stand there, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody's really looking, nobody's moving. But so on, who pray for? How many men and women, how many young people? How many college students, how many middle school, high school students, how many kids would say, Brother Tino, please remember me, please pray for me. I'm not sure that I've ever really settled this in my life, but I need God's love, I need His forgiveness. And Brother Tim, I do want to be saved, and I want to be saved before it's too late. So I'm going to pray for it, so I'll pray for you. You also lift your hand tonight. That's right, just lift your hand, Tim, remember me, pray for me. I need Jesus in my heart. I need Jesus in my life. I see one young lad, and I'm going to pray for him in just a moment before I pray for this one. Brother Evans, and anyone else, and say, Tim, remember me. I need God's love. I need His forgiveness. I want to be saved as well. Would you also lift your hand? Anyone else want to? You know, I want to pray. That's awesome. Tonight, let me pray for you, buddy. I'll be honest with you. My prayer's good. My prayer, it don't seem anybody needed to pray. That's what I'd like to do is pray for you. But then I'd like to lead you to pray. You can pray. I'll tell Jesus you love Him. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for you. Ask Him to forgive you of your sin and invite Him to come into your life to be able to do your sin. You say, how do you know He'll save me? Well, Tim, as He said so, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I'll see you know, well, He said, I'm faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse of all your sin. By the way, He saved me. I'm on top of that. He saved about 12 folks this week. Young man, He'll save you if you ask Him. And if you trust Him, He'll save you. So, Christian friends, please pray for this young man and others. Maybe they may not raise their hand, that tonight will be the night they settle this with the Lord. Heavenly Father, I love you. I thank you for the opportunity to share a real simple message about giving our lives and living sacrifice, but it's hard to do that if we don't have a relationship with you. How can I give you my life if I don't know you? And so, Lord, I pray right now for those that are here, this young man and maybe others, that did not raise their hand and say, I'm not sure I'm saved, but I'm going to be. Lord, I know you love them. I know you died on the cross for them. I know you've been risen from the grave. Lord, we mention that you're alive and that you're well, that you have the right hand of the Father. Lord, that you're willing to cleanse us and forgive us and save us. Lord, I pray that today will be the day where this young man and maybe others simply pray and invite Jesus Christ, you, to come into their life to be their one and be their Savior. Lord, I pray this with all my heart, that those that pray, those that really pray, will never, ever be ashamed to be called a Christian. Would you pray with me, young man? Just pray with me. Would you do that? And others, just pray with me. Say, Jesus, not out loud, but just quietly, Jesus, I love you, and I thank you for loving me. By the way, you put that love on the cross, no doubt about it. And then would you thank him? Just thank him. Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. By the way, he died for the world. He died for the sins of this world. He died for me and you, but he died for you personally. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me and dying on the cross for me. Let me be honest with you. Say, Jesus, I admit that I am a sinner. Well, I know I've sinned. I know I've disappointed the Lord. I know maybe I've had attitude, or I've been rebellious, or I've lost my cool. Just be honest about it. God, I'm a sinner. God, forgive me and cleanse me of all my sin. I'm sorry. I repent is the word we use. I'm sorry for my sin. And then would you trust Him? Just ask Him, Jesus, by faith, I ask you, come into my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Lord Jesus, save me right now. Save me from hell and save me to heaven. and you pray that, would you thank you? Just thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your forgiveness. And Jesus, thank you for saving me here tonight. Let's bow with eyes closed before we close the moment of song. We'll close up with prayer. I wonder how many men and women and young people, even kids, say, Brother Tim, anybody else prayed with you? I've never prayed a prayer like that where I really meant it or understood it. But tonight, Tim, I prayed with you. I made that prayer in my heart. And as far as I know, Brother Tim, I asked Jesus to save me and to forgive me. And I'm glad that I did. If you prayed with me tonight, and you left that prayer in your heart, and you're glad that you did, would you just simply lift your hand one last time? All over this building, just lift it up. I prayed with you, Tim. I asked the Lord to forgive me and cleanse me. I asked the Lord to come into my life, to be my Lord, and to be my Savior. Those that prayed with me, I'm going to ask you, would you give me the privilege of just looking up at me just for a moment, those that prayed with me. I don't think I'll even let you tell you to your marriage, and if you don't mind, you're going to look this way. Well, I'm going to just make things clear. Number one, the prayer doesn't save anybody. The prayer has never saved anybody, but the one we pray to, his name is Jesus, that is the Savior. But we communicate through prayer these words. We talk to the Lord. So really, tonight, you pray and ask the Lord to forgive you and to come into your life to be your Lord and be your Savior. Ask it is, are you ashamed or embarrassed of Jesus? Sir, are you ashamed or embarrassed of Jesus? No way. Man, are you ashamed? No way. Man, over here, are you ashamed? No way. Last question, you should not. I pray, I'm glad I did, I love him, I'm not ashamed of him. Think about this, would you be ashamed tonight for the world today? And really, Georgia, Alabama, Ohio, Nebraska, Texas, Oklahoma, California, the world knew. All over China, Philadelphia, the world knew. You put your faith and trust in Christ. Would you be ashamed for the world? I'm sure you wouldn't be ashamed. Maybe you wouldn't be ashamed. Wouldn't be ashamed. Let me say something. You can't get all big born in America and everybody know. You got to be one of Billy Graham's kids or something like that to do that. But you have friends, though, and family. Those at work know, those at home know, those at school know, those in this room know. But tonight, by faith, I say this. By faith, I ask the Lord to cleanse me and forgive me and save me. And now I want to be for you. I want to be for you. In a moment, we're going to stand. In a moment, my brother over here is going to say a hymn of invitation. And she's going to play the piano. We're going to play the world's hymn of invitation. It's just a song we sing encouraging folks like you to not be ashamed of the Lord and let the world know what God has done in your life. That's really what this is all about. And so the moment when we stand, and when she begins to play, it begins to sing, literally almost from the back row, almost from the back row, all the way to the front on either side. And I will ask those adults and anyone else that prayed with me to simply leave your seat and come up and say, Pastor, I asked Jesus to save me tonight. I prayed with Brother Tim, and I'm glad I asked him to be my Savior. And forgive me for all my sin. Young man, I'm sorry in a moment when we stand and we'll ask you to say, excuse me, and bump that guy out of the way. I know him, you know him, and he'll be for you. Probably you got the furthest to come, but I'm asking you to come. Probably about 13, 14 steps, and he'll be right here. This sweet little lady over here, probably the closest, will say, excuse me, I think that's your husband, he'll probably move out of your way. Probably going to be done, and then just come and say, preacher, I've settled this, and I know Jesus, I trust you Christ. Dear sweet lady, if you also prayed with me tonight, I encourage you to come this morning. Let's be obedient, all right? Let's be obedient. Let's stand to our feet, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. These guys are playing and singing. Pastor, you come and stand right here. As he sings, you need to come in right now. Come on, right now. Let's tell you what you're saying. I've never given my life a living sacrifice. God bless you. And then I ask another question. How many others would say, Brother Tim, I've given God things, but kind of like you, I've taken them back. And I need to renew my mind that those things belong to Him as well. How many folks have that testimony? Would you also lift your hand tonight? Men and women, young people, God bless you. And then how many all would say, Brother Tim, I've given my all to Him, but you know what? He's been so good to me. And He's blessed me in such an overwhelming way. But I need to be reminded that He has all the all that Tim, I need to give Him to do. The new, how He's blessed me so much. I need to renew my mind. The old is His, but the new belongs to Him as well. Would you also lift your hand tonight? God bless you. In a moment, my brother's going to sing, and I'm going to ask friends, maybe just to take each other by the hand, a husband and wife, and come and say, hey, we need to give our marriage, we need to give our kids, we need to give our all for the Lord. Maybe a single adult needs to come, and our senior adult needs to come, and maybe sit on this front pew and say, Lord, here's my life, my mind, my eyes, my ears, my tongue, here's everything. I give it all to you. Some of you need to come and renew your mind, the old is here. Some of you need to come and say, God, I'm giving you this. But I'll tell you that back before I destroy it, ruin it. God, I'm giving this back to you, holy to you. What I'm giving this area of my life to you. I'm asking you to be obedient. Please don't stand here and say, I shall not be moved. And move for the Lord. Be willing to humble and yield and come and pray. Believe you're saved by all the hearts to the Father. My brother's going to sing. And as he sings, in Jesus' name, you come, make that commitment to the Lord tonight. He's singing now. And as he sings, teenagers, mom and dads, senior adults, mothers, you come. As he sings, you're praying. He's saying, God, this is for you. Please come. Teenager, I encourage you to come. Say, God, I give you my all. I give you my life. A living sacrifice. Folks are praying. I'm asking someone to just pray. As you pray, it's time. You take your time and pray. The altar's open for them. It's not too late to come. And you're here tonight. You say, I need Jesus. I need to be saved. I didn't look at you. I didn't raise my hand. But I'm not right with God. Please come. And if you're tonight, you're not a member of this fellowship, and you'd like to be a part, I encourage you to come. Maybe like last night or the night before, I talked about having your baptism on the right side of the cross. Maybe you need to come and say, Pastor, I'm saved, but I need to follow Him and believe His baptism. As He plays, be faithful, just come. say, yeah.
Yeah.
You love him, say, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I've got to get back to that. Yeah. The Georgia fans, I remember that weird church. We got the Alabama fans in here. We got the Florida fans in here. Any Georgia Tech fan. Oh, we need to pray for them. Amen. You know, I know this is going on a little different. And I know that your pastor is you know, high-class kind of guy and sharp. I'm just not as sharp as you. So this time, I'm thinking we get excited about football. We ought to be able to get excited about football. Amen. And so, if you love the Lord, say amen. If you love him, say, oh. You love him, say yeah. You love him, say oh yeah. Hey, 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 give me a J. E. S. U. S. What's that spell? Who do you love? Who loves us? Where are you going when you die? Y'all ain't sure. I don't know. Hey, listen, let me just say one. So honored to be at the Pastor Baptist Church. Pastor Church, and the pastor that beautiful word each and every day, some of the certain times of day. And I always remember this fellowship. I always pray for your preacher when I go by. And now I know more about him. I'm praying for his wife. Amen. Amen. And she'll just have mercy on this soul. But it's been fun. I hope you'll have a good time. Listen, let this church, like a priest on the Sunday.